just run random motility analysis in APR1 knockout mouse embryonic fibroblast. Basically, what this is that we want to learn the effect of a protein, which is API1, by taking it out and seeing the effect. So an extreme example, for example, like a human person, like trying to learn the effect of an eye. If you take out your eyes, you can't see. So then you know that you need your eyes to see. So basically, basically we want to find out the effect of API1 knockout proteins and random motility. So what is cell motility? Cell motility is basically like it describes single cell organisms that move in the environment. They move to like find food or sleep in like environments, different environments, or avoid death. So cells move around for different reasons. In multicellular organisms, cell motility enables single cells and groups of cells to migrate to the embryo in the appropriate location. So this is when embryos grow, cells combine to form tissues, which forms organs, etc. And this can also lead to cancer if it's uncontrolled. Cells that are replicating uncontrollably that can lead to cancer. So, but basically what you need to know out of this is that cell motility is basically describes cell movement. How is cell motility measured? There are various ways to measure it, but in our laboratory, we didn't have technology, so basically we had to manually trace cells. We had a microscope and a video camera connected to the actual cell plate, and it took pictures of images in 15-minute intervals, and then I had to sit on the computer and trace the cells, and then, yeah. So this is the cytoskeleton. Basically, the actin network, the intermediate filaments, and microtubules all work together to advocate or support moving cells. And the API1 protein, which we were studying, has to do mainly with intermediate filaments. Okay, so now we're getting into the experiment. This is the complex controlling actin depolymerization. So these are all proteins that work together for the actin molecule to form, which allows cells to move based on where they need to go. And among these proteins is the API1, which is what our laboratory was trying to study the effect of it. And I couldn't find the picture online, so I had to draw it. Here, I'll need to do this. So for example, this is the cell, basically. Here's the nucleus. These little circles are, right here, these are the actin molecules. Outside is polymerization, where they're lined up. They line up on top of each other. And the cell has to cover it, so the cell keeps moving for these lines. The cell, if the cell breaks, then it's basically dead. So the cell has to cover it by moving, and they're canceled out with depolymerization. They're canceled out from the bottom. And basically what this stuff around it is the proteins, these proteins that help this process happen. And among these proteins is the API1. So our hypothesis is that since the API1 is found in this process, if we take it out, then there's going to be an impairment in this process, or something is going to go wrong. Not wrong, just something is going to be different. So the best technology. So we started 30 hours. Like, we had the cells in the plate for 30 hours. Images were collected at 15-minute intervals, over 960 minutes with a video camera. This is what we measured cell motility in. The distance rate, that should be and directional resistance and migration path, which I'll describe in a second. And these cells were manually traced for each frame. That took a long time. And we used a computer program called NHJ from the NIH and Microsoft Excel to basically track the cells and how them to data. So these were the three methods we were trying to track the cells with. Well, not track, but calculate. So the migration rate is basically a ratio of the total length that it took over the amount of time it took. The migration distance was just how long the distance was from point A to point B that the cells traveled, and the directional persistence. This is basically the distance during the 960 minutes. The ratio of the direct distance over the total length. So, here's an example. So basically this is the NHJ software that we're using. Here are the cells, like these dark spots are the cells. And I had to sit down and track the cells, like each cell by itself. For the directional persistence, basically, directional persistence, basically, if the cell, like this cell, for example, started here and went around to go here, so basically, this was the path it took, where in reality, the actual length that it took was from A to B, like this path. So there had to be a reason why the cell went around. There can be a lot of reasons, but we took that in consideration. So here are the results. These two cells were the normal, rat cells, the mice cells, I mean. They had all the proteins, all the genes, everything there, and they had the API1. These were the API1 knockout cells. So these were the cells that we took the API1 protein and the protein out of it. And as you can see in migration distance and migration rate, they were much lower than the normal cells. However, for directional persistence, the API1 knockout cells had a much higher directional persistence than the wild type, which is the normal. What that tells us is basically that taking out the API1 protein did impair or made a difference. We don't want to say impairment or something negative, but as of now, that there is a difference, that taking out that protein from the process did make a difference. And it played, the API1 plays an integral role in the control of actin polymerization, which heavily influences cell motility. We references. Dr. Tetsula, that's head lab, Patricia, that's my mentor.